Good morning. My name is Gina Yeske, and I am a pastor at Simply Grace United Methodist Church. I'm so glad that you decided to come and worship with us this morning. Home. This word has taken on a completely new meaning in 2020. For some, home is a place where you are comfortable. For others, it seems more like a trap that you've been stuck in forever. While the pandemic has highlighted this dichotomy, throughout time, there have always been those who believe there's no place like home, while others love life on the open road. This morning, we will wrap up our series, The Road Trip, with a familiar passage, the story of the lost sons. So I hope you enjoy this worship this morning. Please drop in at any time to simplygraceumc.com to see what else we're up to. God of abundant grace, may your Holy Spirit be with us now as we worship on this day. Open our eyes to truly see one another, even across distances, that we may discover your presence in the smile of another here today. Open our ears to the needs of the world, that we may hear your wisdom in the words spoken around us. And open our hearts to your grace and love, that we may find your guidance and strength for the journey, for ourselves and for one another. Amen.
Pray. Come, let us celebrate the forgiving, reconciling love of God. For once we were lost and felt so far away. Now we have been found and welcomed home. Know that God's love is lavished upon you forever. We rejoice at the news of forgiveness and hope. Come, let us celebrate and praise the God of love. And all God's children said, Amen. Amen.
Okay, now we're set. Hey, Claire. Hey, Emily. Good morning. Thanks for being here. Have a question. Have you guys, I know you have you been on an adventure? Like maybe you've gone to someplace new you've never been before? Or how about, have you tried new foods? That's an adventure in and of itself. And maybe you even moved. Wow. A couple years ago, I had an adventure that took me to Florida, and I spent 4 months in Florida. But you know what? I was so happy to get home. There's no place like home. So I'd like to tell you a story, and it's called a parable. Jesus told parables or stories to his friends and to us, so that we can understand something really, really important that Jesus has to tell us. And this story is about a young man, his adventures, and all about God's love. So you ready for the story? Got your listening ears on? Alrighty. So there was a dad, and he had two sons, and they all lived together, and one day, the young son went up to his dad and said, I want my inheritance now, so he could leave home and go live the life that he wanted. The dad, like any dad, would want his son to be happy, so he gave him his money. And the young man took off with his money, and he went to live in another country. And he lived his life the way he wanted, spending money foolishly, buying everything he wanted. I don't know, maybe it was a lot of games, maybe it was a lot of toys. But one day, poof, all the money was gone because he had spent it. He didn't even have any money for food. He was really hungry. But then what happened? There was a famine in the land, so there was no food anywhere. Everybody was hungry. So the young man, he thought, and he decided, I want to go back home. So, and then he thought, he really, really felt bad about how badly he had misbehaved. Okay, here's a question. Have you ever misbehaved? I know I have. You've never had to have a timeout? No, wow. You're amazing. I've had adult timeouts, so, but what happened as the young man was on his way home, the dad saw him in the distance, and the dad went running to his son, and he threw his arms around him, and he hugged him, and he said how much he loved him and how happy he was to be home, and the young man apologized. He told his dad how sorry he was for his bad behavior, and the dad forgave his son. So sometimes when our words or our actions or even our behavior might be hurtful, and we say we're sorry to the person and they forgive us, we're forgiven because that person loves us. And I want us to say that together, okay? So repeat after me. We are forgiven.
We are forgiven
because of their love for us. For their love of us. So So Jesus told this story so that we would know something beyond important about God. That sometimes, you know, and we might act like that young man in the story, and we go off doing our own thing. We're not obedient to God's word, and we're not sure God's going to forgive us for our actions or our words or our deeds. But this is where you got to have your listening ears on. God does forgive us. When we tell God we're sorry, he is happy. God will always love us. That never changes. That's really important. So I'm going to say it again. God will always love us. That never, ever changes. And God is right there to throw his loving arms around us and welcoming us back home. So one more time, let's say it together. God's love
for me
never changes. Awesome. Okay, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Creator God, thank you for your never, ever ending love, for always being with us in all we do, even when our behavior is hurtful or unkind. And when we are sorry, we are graced with forgiveness. And all God's children said,
Amen.
Thank you, ladies.
So we have come to our time of offering. And I just want to remind us that today, that our offering is more than paying bills or making sure that the bills can get paid at church. Our offering is what we give to God. And so this morning, I want you to just think about, what are you giving to God this morning? And just place it in your hands and lift it up when Judy prays our prayer. Brothers and sisters in Christ, we have received much from God, grace and mercy and abundance and the love of Christ and the gift of life itself. In our worship, we praise God and give God thanks for these gifts. And so let us now offer what we can in the way of saying thank you. In gratitude for God's generosity, let us share God's abundance with one another.
So let us pray. Help us to be generous givers, dear Lord, both of our money and our lives, that we might make a difference in this town, our nation, and the world. We ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ, who gave all that he was, that we might know life in all its fullness. Amen.
Amen. And now I ask Jude to read our scripture for this morning. Is it Jude or is it Kim? Kim, to read our scripture for this morning.
Good morning. Our scripture today comes from Luke chapter 15, verses 11 through 32. The parable of the lost son. To illustrate the point further, Jesus told them this story. A man had two sons. The younger son told his father, "I want my share of your estate now before you die." So his father agreed to divide his wealth between his sons. A few days later, this younger son packed all his belongings and moved to a distant land. And there he wasted all his money in wild living. About the time his money ran out, a great famine swept over the land and he began to starve. He persuaded a local farmer to hire him, and the man sent him into his fields to feed the pigs. The young man became so hungry that even the pods he was feeding the pigs looked good to him, but no one gave him anything. When he finally came to his senses, he said to himself, "At home, even the hired servants have food enough to spare, and here I am dying of hunger. I will go home to my father and say, 'Father, I have sinned against both heaven and you, and I am no longer worthy of being called your son. Please take me on as the hired servant.' So he returned home to his father. And while he was still a long way off, his father saw him coming. Filled with love and compassion, he ran to his son, embraced him, and kissed him. His son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against both heaven and you, and I am no longer worthy of being called your son." But his father said to the servants, "Quick, bring the finest robe in the house and put it on him. Get a ring for his finger and sandals for his feet. And kill the calf we have been fattening. We must celebrate with a feast, for this son of mine was dead and has now returned to life. He was lost, but now he is found." So the party began. Meanwhile, the older son was in the fields working. When he returned home, he heard music and dancing in the house, and he asked one of the servants what was going on. "Your brother is back," he was told, "and your father has killed the fattened calf. We are celebrating because of his safe return." The older brother was angry and wouldn't go in. His father came out and begged him, but he replied, "All these years I've slaved for you and never once refused to do a single thing you told me to. And in all that time, you never gave me even one young goat for a feast with my friends. Yet when this son of yours comes back after squandering your money on prostitutes, you celebrate by killing the fattened calf." His father said to him, "Look, dear son, you have always stayed by me, and everything I have is yours. We had to celebrate this happy day, for your brother was dead and has come back to life. He was lost, but now he is found." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
So, you're cruising along, the radio's on, you have a destination in mind, and life is good. You've planned the route, you know the best pit stops along the way, and this is going to be the road trip of a lifetime. But somewhere a half hour ago, you made a turn, and now instead of being on the highway barreling toward your destination, you are on a small, windy road. There's no town, there's no building, there's no people, and you're watching the cell bars disappear. Let's face it, you're lost. Now, while GPS and Waze have made it getting lost a lot harder than it was before, there are still times when we find ourselves off the planned route and plain lost. The feeling of being lost can range anywhere from, "Oh, this can be a bit of an adventure," to, "I'm a little bit anxious," to downright scary. I know of there have been more than a few times that I have found myself there. How about you? Have you ever found yourself lost? Maybe on a road trip? Maybe on a journey of the heart? I'm not sure about you if you're like me, but I am pretty stubborn. So when I get lost, the hardest thing to admit is the fact that I am lost. And I need to take that first move to turn around and head back home. In the parable today, we have two sons, one who has been on the road traveling and the other never left home. Ironically, they are both lost. Will you pray with me, please? Amazing God, we thank you for meeting us this morning wherever we are. And we thank you for the directions of life. And we ask, and I especially ask, Lord, that this sermon touches us so that we know how to get on the right path home. Amen. So on this day, Jesus is enjoying a meal with some of his followers, and he overhears the religious leaders, the church people, complaining about the company that he's keeping. Why would Jesus eat with those people, the tax collectors and the sinners? And in response, Jesus shares a few stories about a coin, about a sheep, and about a son. And all of them are lost. Now, we are probably pretty familiar with these parables, especially the one of the prodigal son, the plight of the younger son. And Jesus begins this story with, there is a man that has two sons. And the younger son becomes lost in outrageous living, and he leaves when he leaves home. Now time passes, and he has recklessly wasted away all his riches to the point that he has nothing left. And he's hungry, and he's homeless. And his mouth is watering for the food that goes to the pigs. The pigs are being fed better than him. And so he realizes he has hit rock bottom. Sometimes we get lost. I know I do. And for this prodigal, it was easy to get lost. He was so intent on pleasing himself that he had no thought about any loss or pain that he might have caused himself or anyone else. But soon, his good life turned to bad, and he ends up completely off course. Time passes, and he determines that being a hired hand at his father's house is far better than being the place where he is. His current condition is one he can't live in any longer, and it would be better to give up the life of a son to be instead a servant. And so despite the difficulties that he knows he can face, he makes up his little speech of forgiveness, of asking for forgiveness, and he sets up on the journey home. Often, we see our younger selves in that story of the younger son. But let's not fool ourselves. There are probably more recent times when we have said to God, look, I want it my way. And we've wandered away. When he is still a far way off, he's just this little speck on the horizon. His father sees him. Clearly, he's been watching and waiting and hoping that his son would finally come home. And when he sees him, he doesn't wait. He takes off sprinting toward the son. And before the son can even share the speech that he has prepared, his father embraces him and orders the servants to come and put on a robe and give him the family ring again and put shoes on his blistered feet. And then he says, let's throw a party, for this son of mine was dead and now he is alive again. He was lost and now he is found. Now, just when we are about to put the nice the end on the end of the story, we're reminded that Jesus began with, there was a man who had two sons. This story isn't only about the prodigal, but it is about both sons. So the older son, he's out in the field working, and he is reminded. He's out in the field working, and he hears music and laughter and singing. And as he comes near to the house, he asks the servant, hey, what's going on? And he says, haven't you heard? Your brother has come home, and your father has invited friends and prepared a great feast to celebrate that he's back home safe and sound. And the older son, he isn't happy. He is absolutely furious, and he refuses to go into the party. He wants nothing to do with this. From the older son's perspective, such generosity is simply not fair. If anyone has been a parent of more than one child, you probably know the not fair argument. He was the good son. He shows up for work every day. He does his job. He lives properly. He follows all the rules. When he discovers about this feast and celebration offered for that younger son, he doesn't deserve it. And so he is not a happy camper. Now the truth is becoming clearer. This man has two lost sons. Although the older brother remained physically within his father's house, emotionally, he was in a distant country, more distant than even his brother had ever been. He had not stayed out of love, but he remained out of compulsion. Maybe you identify with the older brother. You're dutiful and faithful and dependable. And maybe you have a little bit of righteous indignation. He's got a pretty good case. It hardly seems fair to have all this fuss about one who runs off and makes a mess out of everything. What about me? He's saying. Have you ever asked yourself, or maybe asked God, the same thing? So how does the father deal with this? He does the same thing as with the younger son, with gentle kindness. He says to the son, please come in and share my joy with me. I have never stopped loving you. You are always my son, and everything that I have is yours. But today we're celebrating your brother's return. But that doesn't lessen what I feel and have for you. Well, it's pretty easy to see the lost condition of the younger son. The older son, it's not quite as clear cut. He got lost in his own home, in his own self-righteousness. Both sons, in their own way, misunderstand the workings of God's grace. In the end, both are welcome home, and the father forgives both of his sons. He forgives the older brother's sanctimonious attitude. That does not wipe out his sonhood any more than the younger brother's excesses. Funny thing, instead of a lecture or some other corrective measure, the father offers nothing but words of love for either of his sons. In the face of his younger son's remorse, he orders the servants to dress the boy like a prince. And in the face of his older son's despair, he says, son, you are always with me, and for that, all that I have is yours. The father is able to see the needs of both of the sons. Jesus is able to see the needs of the Pharisees and the tax collectors, and what the faithful and the wanderers need is each other. The older son could use a little bit of humility, and the younger son could use some devotion. The younger son is the first to take that step, recognizing that he was lost, and he turns around. Now, how does the evening end? That lies in the older son's ability to change his course. Will he go into the party? Or will he stand his ground? Jesus doesn't tell us how the story ends. However, we do know in the end that Pharisees can never grasp Jesus's love for the sinner, nor are they able to ever see themselves in need of God's grace. We all come into the party the same way, broken, selfish, and it is only through the extravagant, excessive, lavish, reckless, and costly love of our God that we are welcomed home. The God who greets us all with open arms and holds a big feast for us that we do not deserve, who also rejoices with us when we stay faithful and work with the kingdom. And so for the younger prodigals today, God offers you grace, and so let us celebrate. And for the older siblings here today, God offers you grace, and let us celebrate. May we always celebrate that love for us and for each other, for we are all welcomed home. Amen.
Sinner, lost and left to die, but raise your head, for love is passing by. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted and carried far away, and precious love has washed away the stain. Sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus and live. And like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to call. Remember when you walk, sometimes we fall. Fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus and live. Sometimes the way is lonely and steep and filled with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours the rain, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus and live. And when the love spills over and music fills the night, and when you can't contain your joy inside, then dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus and live. And with your final heartbeat, kiss the world goodbye, and go in peace and laugh on glory's side. And fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus and live. Fly to Jesus and live.
And now let us go to our time. Amazing God, we are so grateful for that grace that you offer us all. We thank you, Lord, that you watch for us, that you watch for our brothers and sisters that we are not even watching for yet, and that you welcome all your children home with welcome arms. And Lord, in these difficult times, it's easy to have narrow vision about our own needs and our own family's needs. But help us, Lord, to see all of those who you celebrate, all of those who you love. And Lord, you know all our needs, even those that we might not even know yet ourselves, even those that we dare not say aloud. You know those who are on this call who need your healing. You also know the ones that we love that need healing. We call out to you, Lord, that we need healing from this coronavirus, that you provided in some way to release us all from this bondage, Lord. We also need ways to see and to love one another. And so we lift these things up as we pray the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Again, I have you.
I have you.
You have me.
You have me.
We have each other.
We have each other.
We'll reach out to others. And God has us all.
God has us all.
Have a wonderful week, my friends.
You too. Thanks, Gina.